I really wouldn't want to be buying a car right now in that kind of mid to small segment, because you've got a hell of a lot of choice.
I'm glad you qualified that, because I say, well, because you don't have any money. I don't either. Tough, eh?
Lots of choice.
And choice, it's like the old SABC TV days. You know, when you only had three channels, you complained there's nothing to watch.
Yes.
Now you've got a whole DSTV bouquet and you still complain there's nothing to watch. It's kind of the same with cars, all this choice.
Yeah, there's loads of cars in this segment and it makes it even more difficult to choose what to buy.
So now things are getting more complicated, because what do you actually buy?
I don't know, but now you've got an additional choice, because this week we're driving the Hyundai i20, just recently launched in South Africa. From a styling point of view, we really like the i20. It does have some interesting lines, like that curve down the side that ends over its bum. But for the most part, it's just simple design. Cute and compact without being boring. Not necessarily a standout in the crowd kind of car.
Makes sense being in a shopping mall, doesn't it? In the parking area anyway. It's quiet now, but this would be a good indication coming here on a packed Saturday afternoon. You'd see the choices people are making when it comes to cars.
Absolutely, and there, as we said, there's a whole lot of choice, apart from the obvious, which is the Mazda 2, the Fiesta, the Jazz, the Toyota Yaris, or Yaris, as you like to say.
Suzuki Swift.
Yeah, those are the obvious choices, but I mean, there's also things like the Renault Sandero, which I think is in a bit of a different market, but you're insistent that
it's got four doors, same size, well priced.
Yeah, but
City Golf, the 1.6 Sport, I mean,
again, I think it's a different market.
Not at all. You're a crash test dummy in it, but it's the exact same four doors.
It's a lot cheaper. I mean, you're paying.
It is.
105.
105 for it.
And it's got good power.
That's just the competitors.
Yeah.
But Hyundai themselves are pretty confused as well, because there's so much choice when it comes up. You've got the Accent, which has sedan or hatch option. You've got the Getz.
Yeah.
And now the i20, and I just don't get it.
You don't get it. Are you getting confused?
I'm very confused.
Well, look, the Getz has done really well for Hyundai in South Africa. It was a car that kind of put them back on the map.
Maybe that's why the same with the Atos. When the i10 came out, they didn't get rid of it, because it's got a following in South Africa.
Yeah.
It's a cheaper option. And I guess they're going the same route with the i20, keeping the Getz available.
Yeah.
I haven't driven it yet. I'm about to. Heads up in terms of drive.
Power's great. 91 kilowatts. This is 1.6. You also get a 1.4. And for the 10 grand difference, I mean, it's a bit of a no-brainer, really. Yeah. Why not just go for the 1.6?
Well-specced.
Very well-specced inside. Look, I think the closest real competitor to this is the Suzuki Swift, in terms of its price, its power, its spec.
I like the looks. I mean, I think the Swift, for me, does a little bit more. But I think this is a very pretty, pleasant-looking looking vehicle.
It's inoffensive.
But it's amazing how aggressive Hyundai have become. I mean, everybody else's market sales are dropping, and Hyundai's on the increase.
Yeah.
And they're now also attacking the compact market from from an environmentally friendly aspect. So, the Koreans are doing something right.
It's a tough market. And it's all the little extras you get that are really going to set the i20 apart. Central locking, keyless entry, fogs, seat adjustment for both driver and passenger, aircon, day-night rearview mirror, trip computer, satellite steering controls, electric windows front and rear. It even has electric folding mirrors. There's such a long list of extras that all combine to make you feel like you're driving possibly a more expensive car.
One thing, just from initial impressions, that I don't like are the seats. Remember the frumpy old grannies used to buy those seat covers they used to put in their old beautiful Toyota Corrallas with the little bumps and the knobblies? That print looks exactly like that. I mean, what is that?
It looks a bit like a floor mat, actually.
No, you're not wiping your feet, you're wiping your butt in it.
But you know what else about those seats? I actually don't find it very comfortable. It's got quite a hard, you'll see when you sit in it, at the bottom, it's quite a hard base. And also with my seating position, same as the Suzuki Alto, it's got that bar that hits my legs, but that's just me, maybe. Yeah, I sit far forward.
No, but they also probably need to cut away underneath the steering column to give you more leg room down there.
Yeah. It's a surprisingly sprightly engine that's also really fuel efficient. Combined cycle is quoted by Hyundai at 5.9 litres per 100 k's, and we showed close to this on our general driving during the test week. By the end of my time with the car, I was really quite impressed with its overall ride for a car in this class.
Just to end off though, and it's just a personal thing, all these Korean cars that come out, lovely to look at, stacked to the hilt with extras, but then they've got the most bizarre name for their tyres. I mean, you get Bridgestone, you get Continental, that sound like real tyres, and then they come up with Camho.
Let's just leave that.
Sticky topic, huh?
Sticky topic.